Hello, everyone. I'm Danny Barta. I'm a PhD candidate at the American Museum of Natural History's Richard Gilder Graduate School. And I'm here today to discuss a new study that was published just a couple of days ago in the scientific journal Nature that's really causing some people to maybe rethink our thoughts about the dinosaur family tree. So before I get into the details and implications of the study, I think I'll just start out very basically with kind of tell the story of how we have figured out our traditional idea of what the dinosaur family tree looks like. So right next to me, this is, of course, Tyrannosaurus rex. This is a carnivorous dinosaur. It belongs to a group of dinosaurs called theropods. And this is the group of dinosaurs that includes birds. And then across the hall from me here, this is a dinosaur called Apatosaurus. It belongs to the group of dinosaurs called Sauropods. And these are two of really the three major groups of dinosaurs we're going to talk about today. The others are all in the museum's Hall of Ornithischian Dinosaurs. And so these three groups were all recognized very early on in the study of dinosaurs, almost immediately after Sir Richard Owen named dinosaurs. We had examples of all of these three groups. And in 1887, a scientist named Harry Seeley, who was working in England, he came up with this division of dinosaurs into Ornithischians and Saurischians. And subsequent work for the next 130 years really confirmed his idea of dinosaur relationships, that the sauropods and the theropods were each other's closest relatives within this group called Saurischia, or the Saurischians. And the Ornithischians were their sister group. That's what we call when two groups branch off from a root like this, they are called sister groups. So this was really our traditional picture that was supported by the results of cladistic analysis, which is a means of inferring animals' evolutionary relationships based on patterns of common descent. It's a system of classifying animals according to their common ancestor. A clade is a group of animals that includes its common ancestor, which is represented by these nodes here, these points where the branches join, and then all of its descendants, so all of the animals that descend from that point.
So Danny, tell us how we got to, what were paleontologists looking at when they came to sort of these
Sure.
three groups and how they're related?
Yeah, so some of the major features that paleontologists were looking at, one of them is the arrangement of the dinosaur's hip bones. That's what these groups are really named for. So these are all the lizard hip dinosaurs, and then these are the bird hipped dinosaurs. And it's just the arrangement, it just relates to the arrangement of how their three hip bones all connect with one another. But one of the other major features that Harry Seeley used to group, say, sauropods and theropods together is that they both have spaces for air sacs within their vertebral column. This is much like modern birds have today. And so this may have helped lighten the skeleton, may have aided in respiration. And so that's a major feature that these groups share that ornithischians don't. And so there's many other features besides this, but there was a great weight of evidence supporting this arrangement of the family tree.
Danny, since we're here, Can we maybe point out the hip bone on T-Rex here? I'm sure people would love to get a look at exactly what you're talking about.
So in Saurischian dinosaurs, you have this bone right in front here between the legs with sort of this big boot shape on it. This is called the pubis. And in Saurischian dinosaurs, as in lizards and other kinds of reptiles, the pubis is pointing more forwards towards the head. Whereas in an Ornithischian dinosaur, I have a picture of this dinosaur called Heterodontosaurus here. It's a very primitive Ornithischian. It may be difficult to see, but the pubis is actually pointing backwards in these animals. So that's probably one of the more obvious differences between these groups. So maybe we'll walk down this way and look at some early examples of members of both the theropod and sauropod groups.
Sounds fantastic.
And talk a little bit more about the new findings.
What's this new paper
so this new paper, yeah. So now that we've done our work of introducing dinosaurs, this new paper is the result of quite a comprehensive new cladistic analysis that takes into account really a greater number of different dinosaur species and different anatomical features than previous studies have done. So I think it's a very thorough piece of work in terms of examining lots of different types of dinosaurs and their anatomy. And so what this study has done, when they build their data matrix of anatomical features, basically transforming the anatomy of the animal into a matrix of zeros and ones. So a zero we usually put down in the matrix if an anatomical feature is absent, and we'll put in a one if it's present. And so then we run this matrix through a computer algorithm, and that will tell us what the most best arrangement of the tree is based on those features. And so they ran this through a computer, and they got out a result that no one has ever really found before in a cladistic analysis of dinosaurs. So this is the tree that they uncovered. So remember, we have our sauropods, our theropods, and our ornithischians. Before, the theropods with the sauropods over here. Now, the theropods are the sister group to the ornithischians, and they name this group Ornithoscelida. And this is actually kind of a resurrection of an old name that Thomas Huxley had applied to some dinosaurs. He was Charles Darwin's great supporter. He had come up with that name, but they sort of resurrected this old name to refer to this new grouping of theropods and ornithischians, which maybe on the face of it seems somewhat counterintuitive or contradictory based on things like the hip bones that we looked at. But taking into a lot of different features into account, the authors found evidence that this grouping is supported based on characters in the skull, characters in the limbs, other characters throughout the body.
Let's maybe get in front of one of these specimens.
Sure.
And talk about some of the features they may be taking into account.
Yeah, sure. So this is an early member of the sauropod lineage. So this is Platyosaurus. And you can see it has that typical saurischian arrangement of pelvic bones where the pubis is pointing forward. But maybe that isn't such a good character as what these authors of the study in Nature might argue. But there's many characters throughout the body. Some of them relate to the shape of the shoulder blade, for example, the shape of the upper arm bone, the humerus. Others that are present in the skull. And so these are features that would not be present in this dinosaur that are actually separating out the sauropod group from the theropods and ornithischians. I think going forward, some of these anatomical features are going to be heavily debated, and sort of the interpretations of them will be argued about in the literature going forward. But I think this study does a very good job of maybe challenging us to rethink some of our assumptions based on really a wealth of new evidence. But I would say it remains to be seen, whether this will become sort of the new orthodoxy for the next 130 years, or who knows, maybe there will be new dinosaurs discovered, later this year that, might overturn this whole thing. We just don't know. Because anytime you find a new species and you put it into an analysis like this, it has the potential to change the arrangement of the evolutionary tree. So science is always discovering new things, always moving forward. I think one important thing to keep in mind is that all the things that we've learned about dinosaurs previously, about their biology, so about the way dinosaurs grew, about the way they reproduced, about their eggs, about their behavior, all of those things haven't really changed. Maybe the distribution of some of those things on this tree has, you know, maybe changed, but all the things we've been able to infer about dinosaurs, you know, this has not, altered our perspective on any of the biology of dinosaurs as living animals.
Danny, you mentioned that this is challenging sort of a pretty long-standing way of thinking. Have these assumptions been challenged before? Is this something that's been sort of thought about a lot, or something that was kind of, you know, we thought we had this settled 130 years ago, and now it's being brought up again?
Yeah, so I think there's been, you know, some challenges throughout the past 130 years to the traditional arrangement of dinosaur relationships. But these have always kind of taken the form of just observations of like, oh, isn't this weird that the theropods and ornithischians share an anatomical feature. But no one has really had previously put some of these features into an analysis and really found on the weight of a cladistic analysis that that this new picture of relationships might instead be a more accurate depiction of the relationships.
Fantastic. We got a couple questions coming in from Facebook, but well, when we field those, why don't we've got a fossil over here that I think is pretty close to your heart.
Yes,
maybe you can introduce us to this guy.
Yeah, so this is a very primitive theropod dinosaur. This is Coelophysis. So Coelophysis is one of the earliest members of this group that includes Tyrannosaurus rex. And so I think one interesting thing when we look at Coelophysis and when we think about that Plateosaurus that we just saw, and then we look at this Heterodontosaurus, the primitive ornithischian. So when we look at the sort of primitive members of all of these groups, they all look relatively similar. And when you go even earlier in time and you find even earlier theropods and even earlier sauropods, they start looking even more similar. And this is one of the reasons why this problem has been really difficult to figure out, because all the early members of these groups, right down towards their origins, all are quite similar in the sense that they're all small, they all walk on their hind legs, they all have these grasping hands, which you can see on Coelophysis there as well. They share certain features throughout the rest of their skeletons that... it's really difficult to sort of sort out relationships when these animals are so either sharing primitive features or they're convergently evolving on similar body types. And so it's difficult to sort out, you know, what exactly is going on. It's really, you know, easy to see that the later represented these groups are very different from one another, like a Tyrannosaurus versus an Apatosaurus versus a Triceratops. Those are all very different looking dinosaurs, but when you find their earliest ancestors, they're all pretty similar, and so it can be a bit difficult to sort out. But
and when we talk about an early ancestor, Danny, what's the span of time difference between like the Coelophysis here and the T-Rex we were near earlier?
Sure. So Coelophysis lived about 200 million years ago, and Tyrannosaurus lived about 66 million years ago. So there is there's more time between Coelophysis and Tyrannosaurus rex than there is between Tyrannosaurus rex and you and I standing here today. So that just gives you a sense of just how long the age of dinosaurs was. And you can, you know, really think about how successful dinosaurs were through that whole time to have survived, you know, hundreds of millions of years.
And Danny, maybe... You brought this up a little earlier, but I wanted to sort of dig into it a little more.
Yeah.
What other research might this Nature paper, what might that sort of prompt researchers to look at going forward?
Sure. So I think going forward, this study is going to be heavily debated, and it's actually going to be a very fun debate to watch, because it's, it's not every day that something that's really stood the test of time since 1887 is being, rigorously challenged like this. And so, a lot of the studies going forward now are going to focus on details of the anatomy that were used to support the new findings and the new analysis. They're going to focus on the statistical methodologies that the authors used to build their evolutionary tree, these computer algorithms. Probably new, different statistical techniques will be applied to this study. People will include invariably more specimens and more species of dinosaurs in an analysis like this. And of course, we can't really predict what may be discovered in the future in terms of new dinosaurs. I think this area of dinosaur origins has always been a really hot area of interest. But I think that's going to be even more true going forward. That we need really a lot more specimens of some of these early primitive animals to eventually really sort this out. So things might be a little unstable in terms of figuring out this part of the tree of life for right now, but that happens with many other groups of animals all the time. This is certainly not a scientific question or scientific problem that's unique to dinosaurs. If you work on fish or mammals or any other group, it's things are in flux, and eventually more evidence will accumulate and we'll probably be able to have a more I guess confident answer, maybe at least for the next 130 years. But yeah, science is always increasing the knowledge that we have in terms of specimens and in terms of techniques we can apply to them. So it's an exciting time to be a paleontologist.
Fantastic. And we want to get at least one great conversation going on in the Facebook thread here. We want to. It seems like we're leaving out one thing that people think about when we think about dinosaurs.
Sure.
And Rob Ruiz asks, if pterodactyls aren't dinosaurs, then what are they? Where do sort of the flying dinosaurs we think about fit into this picture?
Yeah, so pterodactyls are not dinosaurs. So no matter which family tree of dinosaurs you use, pterosaurs fall outside of this grouping. So pterosaurs are a side branch. If I would put pterosaurs on this tree, they would be right out here where my index finger is. And so pterosaurs are best thought of as close evolutionary cousins of the dinosaurs. They both belong to a group called archosaurs, which also includes crocodilians and, of course, birds, because birds are dinosaurs. But pterodactyls are not birds, they're not dinosaurs, they're their own separate side branch of archosaur evolution.
Fantastic. Danny, we'll let you get back to what I'm sure is a very busy day.
Sure.
Thanks so much for joining us today.
Yeah, thank you. It was great talking to you.